Hi.
So we actually think we have the question that's in the forefront of your mind at the moment.
That would be 6'7"?
5'1".
But wait, there's more.
Oh, yes.
Blackberry.
iPhone. Don't tell. Mm-hmm. We have our phone.
Peanut butter, chocolate, and you don't want to know the rest.
No, you really... The point really is that we both bring something different to the game.
Yes, and despite 50 years of marriage, that would be 25 for Christy and 25 for me.
It just seems like 50.
Yes, and despite all those years, we've become to realize that, yes, in fact, despite 6'7"
and 5'1",
the reason this works is that we both have what the other one needs.
And So for 20 of those 25 years, we worked at a variety of commercial jobs. I was producing television.
I was writing television.
I was producing movies.
Acting in movies.
And then we kind of got a wake-up call. One was 9/11, and then one was the day I was diagnosed with breast cancer. And we really started thinking about the world that our children would come to know, and what part were we going to play in that. And really, we decided to combine our talents and found that we were in a position to start telling some stories that we felt really needed to be told.
When we started shooting our film Nobility, which looked at the world's problems through the eyes of Nobel laureates, we didn't have any plan beyond one feature film that had a simple premise: let's talk to 9 of the smartest people on Earth and ask them whether we're all screwed.
And we had no idea, really, that that would lead to our nonprofit called the Nobility Project. We produce feature films, short films. We have a large online outreach. We have a Nobility in Schools program. And we have various projects in countries around the world.
That may sound like a lot, but the truth is, it's a lot.
And people ask us sometimes how we do it, and we like to answer.
6'7".
5'1". Really, it's because in the new math, you get to be bigger than the sum of your parts.
Call it TED to the power of X. So today it's all about playing big. And playing big sounds like it could be a lot of fun. But you know, playing big also sounds like it might be a little risky. I've filmed both the Nobility and our new film One Piece at a Time in a lot of places, and some of them did seem a little dicey. Here I am in India at the Muharram, the Shia festival of Ashura. You can see that I fit right in.
Yeah, we call this photo the human Q-tip.
This was not long after the invasion of Iraq, and I was told that as an American, it was far too dangerous for me in the time of shock and awe to be at the Muharram. And I got to say that when thousands of teenagers started waving their swords in front of my face, I was beginning to agree with that assessment. Even more so when I noticed that a group of men had been following me for more than an hour. It wasn't until I spoke to them that I learned they were following me not because they wanted to hurt me, but because they were looking out for me. And once I started to make friends, I began to see all kinds of great ideas. Check out this guy's shirt. If you're looking for a big opportunity, seek out a big problem. So that's what we've been doing ever since, seeking out big problems.
Well, that's certainly what you've been doing ever since. But often as a producer of film, it's your job to say no. And when you're trying to produce a film in many countries around the world, there's a lot of things that don't fit into a shoestring budget. Like, for instance, rebuilding a failing school in Africa.
Yeah. I was filming with the women of the Greenbelt Movement in Kenya. That's Wangari Maathai's organization that's planted 30 million trees in Kenya and transformed the lives of millions of rural women. These women were absolutely fantastic. Wangari was fantastic as well, but there was something missing. I really wanted to plant trees with kids at a school. And I was lucky to meet a local naturalist named Joseph Mutangu, who took me to a school that was really just barely on life support. So here's the school I've come to: mud floors, slat walls, wind and rain coming through, lots and lots of kids, but hardly any textbooks and no school supplies. And despite all that, written above every blackboard, the school's motto: hard work pays. So we planted 100 trees that day with the kids. Great experience. But I couldn't help asking how come some seedlings and trees they'd planted the year before were brown and looked like they might be dying. And the principal told me, he assigned every kid a tree to water. Some of the kids were very small, and it was a long walk to the water. How far? 1.5 miles. So what about the water they drink when they're in school? It's 1.5 miles. They carry it back in buckets. It's from an open stream, and it often makes them sick.
So when Turk called me about this school, the first thing I thought was there's no way we have the money to build a water system for a school in Kenya. And I was coming up with some graceful way to let him down easy. And I realized that these kids were giving me an opportunity, that this problem was now my opportunity to quit saying no.
So we'd like to show you some of what happened when saying yes moved us from making a movie about problems to making one about solutions. We're going to sit down over here and watch the trailer for our new film, One Piece at a Time.
Water is the fundamental need.
We buy the pump, and they dig the well, together, which creates a sustainable solution.
If people can have better agricultural productivity, their future will be better.
And actually, people don't need help. What they need is just the opportunities that allow them to help themselves.
Health is really fundamental. Our well-being has a huge impact on people's ability to work, to cultivate food, and send their children to school. But I think we ought to feel hopeful because there's a lot of potential to have an impact on some of the big killers today.
We're moving from a world of have and have not to a world of no and no not.
If we spend less on military expenses and more on education, imagine the kind of peace and not to mention prosperity that you can buy.
Even the poorest of the poor has enormous potential, enormous creativity, but that creativity is locked up. There's no reason why anybody should be poor.
The idea is the one small thing that could create massive social and economic change.
The dream of their life comes true when they become the architect of their own home, as they become the architect of their own life.
Peace has to be something that's taught, that there is a peaceful solution.
And it is that one step at a time, it's that one village at a time, it's that one person at a time.
There's nothing magical about change. Anybody can do it if they just get up and take the first step.
Raise out of your hands and clear your eyes. You have a right to your dream and don't be denied. I believe in a better way. I believe in a better way.
Did you know they say in Africa, there is only one way of eating an elephant.
What is it?
One piece at a time.
That's great.
I love those kids.
A world of no and no-nots. Wow. One Piece at a Time looks at the possibility of providing basic rights to every child. I filmed in 25 countries on 5 continents. Took 3 years.
Only broke your leg once?
Yeah, but in 2 places. Not 2 different countries, in two places in my life.
I think they got that.
Yeah, okay. So the broken leg did slow us down a little bit, but it didn't prevent me from limping back to Mahiga to see the changes that had come about from saying yes. And those changes did indeed start with water. And this is our new water system. It's the only tap water I'll drink in anywhere in Africa, and the best tasting glass of water I ever had. It also included electricity for the school for the first time, new classrooms, and a computer lab. In 4 years, St. Joseph Mahiga Primary School went from failing to the number one school in the district.
So did that happen because we invested a few $1,000 in these kids' future? You know, maybe. But really what we think happened is that these kids and their parents saw that this was their chance. When we were shooting Nobility with Wangari, she had just won the Nobel Peace Prize for her work as an environmentalist. And one of the things she said was, when people work with their hands, they change their environment in which they live, but they also change themselves. So we really feel like it wasn't what we did, it was what they did that made this work.
So not only was this success created by them, it was really envisioned by them. It was their idea to build a preschool so their kids could start reading and writing early. It was their idea to build a high school.
You know, we all know that education shouldn't end at the 8th grade. And with no high school anywhere in that district, it was every year a group of kids like these girls would have to drop out of school forever. And so not only did we agree to partner with the community on building this high school, we agreed to do it in 1 year.
In 1 year?
Yeah.
How are we doing?
You know, I couldn't say no.
We're actually doing pretty well. We're right on schedule, and so I'd like to show you a little bit of what we think will be, what is some of the components of what we think will be a model for rural schools across Africa. So problem, every school needs water. Opportunity, the rainwater court. The rainwater court is a multi-sport court for boys and for girls, but it's much more than that. Yes, it collects rainwater and provides purified water for system for the school. There's also a stage built into one side, and that makes it an outdoor classroom, makes it a performance space for music, for dance, for theater, makes it a community meeting space. There's all kinds of things the community can do here outside of school, and it's also a movie theater. The Rainwater Court won the Nike Game Changers Award, an international design competition, and with that award came the support of Architecture for Humanity and $60,000 to build the structure. That's the number one. Number two, the classroom block. Oops. And that is not the classroom block, but the classroom block is 8 classrooms. It's hand-cut stone, reinforced steel, reinforced concrete, building that's going to be there for a very long time. It includes a book library and a computer library for the high school. We add to that science building, which has a chemistry lab, and these are Kenyan Education District requirements, a chemistry lab, a physics lab, a biology lab, which we're adding a garden to. Also, there's a kitchen, which will provide the main meal for most of these kids every day. Add it all up, and you've got a total cost of $250,000.
Total benefit for these kids to go to high school? It's priceless. You know, and people ask us, why these kids? And we say, why not these kids? We're a small organization, and we can't engage with every community in need, but we can with this one. And by telling that story, we really feel like we can inspire others to do the same. So when Desmond Tutu says one piece at a time, that he's really talking about all of us.
My dad used to say, you can't build a wall by starting at the top. The Nobility Project work is really built on a foundation of thousands of people who support the work we do and who also play big by sharing in that work.
And when we got within $100,000 of the money we needed for Mahiga Hope High School, we decided we'd find 1,000 people who were willing to donate $100. And we call it the 1,000 Voices for Hope. Willie Nelson was actually our first donor, and he told us that, he said, that's a choir I want to sing in. But that was cute.
So to make it a little more personal than that, after 1,000 Voices for Hope comes a new part of the school, a new component that reaches out to a lot of people. It's called 1,000 Books for Hope. Now, 1,000 Books for Hope will fill the shelves of the library at Mahiga, but we don't want all the old books that you don't want anymore. We want your favorite book. We want a book that really meant something to you in your life. And the idea is you choose that book, you open it up, you write your name, you write the city, the country, the place where you come from, and you write a short note that says why you love this book or why you think it'll be important to these kids.
I was working with a group of students in our Nobility in Schools program, and one of them is an Eagle Scout who's doing his last final project with this campaign, 1,000 Books for Hope. And I was walking through Half Price Books, and I hadn't really given much thought to what book I would choose, what I would write, and what that would really mean to me. So I'd like to actually read you what I wrote. This is the book, Now We Are Six, A.A. Milne. This is the first book I remember my mother reading to me as a little girl, and it's the last book I read to her before she died. Some books last a lifetime.
I have to follow that. My choice for the library is The Boy Who Harnessed the Wind by William Kamkwamba, who has a fantastic connection to TED. And I wrote, Turk Pipkin, Austin, Texas, USA. This is the inspiring story of a boy from Africa who checked out a book on science from a small library and built a windmill that lit up his home and ultimately his hometown.
So really what we've learned is that we are so much more than the sum of our parts, that we're 1,000 donors, we're 1,000 voices, we're 1,000 books.
We're Christy's mom, and we're my dad, we're Joseph Mutangu, we're your first grade teacher. We're the minister who married you. We're the Cunic triplets whose mitzvah project this morning raised $6,400 for the kitchen at Mahiga Hope High School. We're Nobel laureates. We're people who believe in science and in love.
And we're millions of children across the world who need a voice, who need a friend, who need clean water, a good meal, a book, a computer, and a teacher.
And as it turns out, the one main thing that they all need is the same thing that we all need, each other. Thanks.